And the point that I want to share, the idea that I want to share today is this. When we in education, when we enter into that vocation from the right why, we posture ourselves and poise ourselves to make the kind of life-impacting relationships that have the power to change the future. So what I want to do is I want to share a couple of case studies with you, and I think these case studies will do more to illustrate my point than me talking through my research and through data. So the boy on the left is a sixth grade boy. His name is Lou. The girl on the right is a fourth grade girl. Her name is Lauren. Let's talk about Lou. Sixth grade boy, Hispanic male, low socioeconomic home. He's got a single uninvolved parent, history of truancy, history of interaction with the legal system. He's got an undiagnosed depression, and he's using street drugs to self-medicate. Now, if you're a classroom teacher and you have this kid in your classroom, this is the kid that will make you sit out in the parking lot on your campus and have an existential crisis. This is the kid that will make you sit out in February when the snow's piled that high and say, do I really want to walk the 200 yards into that building? Because I didn't sleep well last night, but I guarantee you, Lou slept like a baby, and he's going to be loaded for bear and ready for me. And then you start thinking, you know, like, they don't pay me enough for this. Why am I doing this? And all that goes on. And if you have this kid in your classroom, he will wear you out. And if you have this kid in your classroom and he doesn't wear you out, I would say one of two things is true of you. Either you're a superhero or you're in just a little bit of denial. That's this kid. Well, this kid actually is not in sixth grade anymore. Of all things, this little stinker grew up and became a licensed psychologist, and that's what he looks like today. I was that kid. I was that kid. Let me share my story with you. The setting is the early 1980s. The location is the lower Rio Grande Valley, the very southern tip, very close to the border of Mexico, 95% Hispanic. And I remember the look on my mom's face the first time she had to come to juvenile to pick me up when I was arrested, the anger in her face. And the first words out of her mouth when she saw me was, "What are you doing here? What are you doing here?" And that question, it wasn't a question of action. What am I doing here? Well, I'm sitting in this chair with these handcuffs digging into my wrist, wondering what the next 48 hours of my life will look like. That's not the question she was asking. It was a question of identity. And I remember thinking, what an absolutely stupid question to ask me. Are you kidding me? What am I doing here? I know who I am. I'm Lou Sines. It's my job to make your life hell. I'm never going to learn. I can't make it through a single day. What am I doing here? This is who I am. This is where I belong. This is what I do. Well, my mom, Child Protective Services, was never involved with my family, but my mom could read the writing on the wall. And she voluntarily relinquished guardianship to me. And I went to live with this family several hundred miles away in what was then this tiny rice farming town out in the sticks, out in the suburbs of Houston called Katy, Texas. And I ended up doing pretty well at Katy Junior High and Katy High School. But by my senior year, I started to get depressed again because the family that I lived with, they said, son, we love you, but you're 18, and when you graduate, you're on your own. And I was terrified because I knew, no. When you take all the structure away from me, I knew that I still had demons on the inside, and they were going to come and get me. Well, sure enough, I graduated from Katy High School, and the bottom fell out. I ended up in San Antonio. I was working as a dishwasher. I met this guy. He let me sleep on the living room floor of his tiny one-bedroom apartment. My depression was out of control. I was using drugs again to self-medicate, street drugs. And I wasn't suicidal, but I remember thinking, like, are you kidding me? I'm 19 years old. I'm working as a dishwasher. I'm using drugs. And I've got another 60 years of this to look forward to. What's the point? Well, I remember coming home from work one morning. It was about 3 a.m., very early, and I was really, really depressed and really, really overwhelmed. And so I pulled out my journal. I just needed to get into my journal to write. And as I pulled out my journal, in my journal box, I saw these two letters, and I couldn't figure out what they were. But when I found them, I was blown away at what they were. They were two letters that had been written to me by two of my teachers my senior year at Katy High School. And this is part of what one of those letters said. You're extremely talented and intelligent, but most importantly, you have a good heart. I know you will use your talents to help your fellow man, and that's the most satisfying life a person can have. And it was signed by my English teacher, Joella Exley. It said some other things, but that's what jumped out. Put it away, pulled out the second letter, and this is part of what that letter said. Don't quit writing, especially in your journal. Someday it may be the basis for your book. You have insight, sensitivity, intelligence, and maturity beyond your tender years. Keep being you. You're a special person. And it was signed by my creative writing teacher, Polly McRoberts. And those words absolutely haunted me. They just haunted me because I said, wait a minute, I know who I am. I know who I am. I'm Lou Sines. I'm a 19-year-old version of that sixth grade kid that's never going to make it through a single day, whose job it is to make your life hell, who's never going to learn. I'm using drugs. I'm depressed out of my mind. I'm working as a dishwasher. I have no future. I know who I am. But here were these two women for whom I had tremendous respect that were disagreeing with me. And because of who they were and the kind of life they lived in front of us in the classroom, I couldn't just blow them off. I couldn't just say, well, you don't know what you're talking about. And because of their character and their integrity, I knew they would not have written these words to me if they didn't absolutely believe it. So back and forth I went, back and forth. Who's right about me? Who's right about me? So finally I said, you know what? I need to put this theory to the test. I need to figure out who I am. I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to sign up for a college course. I had no idea how to do that. Neither of my parents went to college. But I went to the University of Texas at San Antonio. I was accepted. The first course I had to take was Introduction to English. And I said, oh, thank God, because if I have any hope of passing a college course, it's got to be this English course. Well, at the end of the semester, I remember I got my grade and I passed it. Couldn't believe it. Couldn't believe it. And so I started thinking, you know what? Maybe Mrs. Roberts and Mrs. Exley were right about me. Maybe they could see something in me that I couldn't see in myself. On the one hand. On the other hand, maybe this was just a clerical error for all I know. Should probably take another course. So I took another course that spring and I passed it, couldn't believe it. And then I took a course that summer, then two, then three, and just kept going a little at a time. And then just before I turned 27 years old, I graduated with my undergraduate degree in English. Never, never, never thought I was going to get a college degree. I never did, but there I had it. And then I started thinking, you know what? They were right about me. Mrs. McRoberts and Mrs. Exley could see something in me that I couldn't see in myself. And I said, you know what? I'm done being Lou. I'm done being that kid that's never going to make it through a single day, whose job it is to make your life hell, who's never going to learn. And then just psychologically, as a way to give myself permission to be somebody else, I said, I'm going to start going by my first name now. I'm going to be Adam. And maybe Adam can live into this life that those two teachers saw in him so many years ago. Well, I started my master's program, and then I started my own therapy to work through my own past, my own trauma, and my own abuse. Finished my master's, and then I applied for a PhD in school psychology at Texas A&M. And then the whole thing came full circle. And it was March of 2001. I remember I was sitting in Logan Airport. I was finishing my internship at Boston Children's Hospital under a fellowship appointment to Harvard. And I was scheduled to graduate in May, and I had applied for postdocs at Brown, Yale, and Columbia. And Brown was my top choice. So I'm sitting in the airport at Logan waiting for my flight. I was going to fly back to College Station to defend my dissertation, and my cell phone rang. I said, hello, this is Adam. And then a voice on the other end of the phone said, Adam, hey, this is Dr. Jay Reeve at Brown Medical School. Listen, we got your paperwork. We really enjoyed our interview with you, and I'm calling to offer you a fellowship appointment here at the medical school. And I was just thrilled. I mean, this was my top choice, right? So as he's talking about the research and the clinical work, I had an incoming phone call, and I didn't recognize the number. And I said, Dr. Reeve, I said, I'm so sorry to ask, but do you mind if I put you on hold? I have a call coming in. I think I need to take it. No problem. Click over. Hello, this is Adam. Then a voice on the other end said, Adam, hey, this is Dr. Chuck Stanislow at Yale Medical School. Listen, we got your paperwork. We really enjoyed our interview with you. And I'm calling to offer you a fellowship appointment to Yale.